All right. Hey, this is musicians having coffee and talking about stuff. Yeah. So this is my guest, the amazing Paul Bielatowicz. Yeah. Good to see you, man. It's been too long.
Great to see you. Great to see you too, Neal. Yeah. Really, really honored to be here and be asked by you to do this. I think I've got as many questions for you as you might have for me. So.
Oh, okay. Well, we'll just have a chat and let things go.
Amazing.
So. Last time I saw you was at the Grand Ole Opry, I think.
That's right. Yeah, the Royal Affair Tour, 2019. Yeah. Yeah, one of the biggest tours I've ever done, followed by the longest period of not touring that I've ever done.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Right. Who knew this was coming? So, but I mean, for me, I feel like it's been perhaps the most prolific and productive time that I've had in terms of writing my own stuff.
Oh, great.
So it's been great for me. It's been really good.
Yeah. Well, yeah, there were a lot of good things for us too. I made the Sola Gratia album and I think I was also working on the new Transatlantic during that time, I think too. I'm kind of adrift. I'm adrift in the centuries. I don't know. I don't always know. But and then since we couldn't, there was very little vacationing or anything that we could do. We got an RV and we took Sherry's dad all over the country, you know, wearing masks and everywhere and gloves, getting gas.
Right.
And
Yeah,
but we went all over and because we could, you know, my idea during COVID was, you know, let's be safe, but let's do what we can do, you know, what's allowed. So we went to a bunch of national parks, had a wonderful time. So there was a lot of good things that happened in 2020 for us.
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah. Well, for me, we left the state. We left Massachusetts for the first time in 18 months. Last week, went up to New Hampshire to a friend's house up there. Spent 2 days up there. That was the first time we went out of the state.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So we've been locked down really. But as I say, it's been. I don't want to say it was great because I know it was miserable for a lot of people. But it's been very productive for me. So I've really appreciated the time to be at home.
You're in the Boston area, are you?
Yeah. South, about an hour south of Boston, small town called Dartmouth, next to a city called New Bedford. I don't know if you've come across New Bedford, but nice down here. Lots of places, lots of beaches to walk to when you can't go anywhere else. So yeah, it's been good down here.
It's good.
And we bought a house about 3 years ago, converted the garage to a studio. And so that's where I spend all of my days.
Yeah, yes. I know exactly what you're talking about. As I look around.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, for people watching who don't know me, I've spent my life as like a hired gun, playing other people's music, and it's been really nice to write my own music for the first time, really. And just spend a lot of time on that. I've got a Patreon page, which has kept me, it's paid the rent and it's kept us alive during the pandemic. It's just
wonderful.
Been amazing. And I made a crazy pledge to my patrons to write every single one of them, all 200 of them, a song each or a piece of music each. So I've been writing songs every single day and it's just been fantastic. Some are terrible and some I'm pleased with, but that's how it goes, isn't it?
Hopefully you're not one of the ones that got one of the terrible ones. We won't ask you which is which.
Exactly.
Well, not everything that comes out is gold.
It's, right.
Sometimes we're not sure. Sometimes, you have to explore it. Sometimes to figure out whether it's working or not, maybe spend some time away from it. And then you go like, this is working. This is good. We should do this. And other times, yeah. Like, I think maybe that's an idea whose time has not come.
Yeah, right. Well, one thing I found is I will write something and it's not quite there. And I don't really want to spend any time rewriting because I've got to get onto the next one. I've got 200 of these to write. But it will kind of inspire something else that then does work. How many of your ideas would you say make it to albums? Do you have lots of discarded ideas and discarded songs?
Yeah, I do. Gosh, I don't know. I wouldn't be able to give a number or percentage. Like for the last Transatlantic, I think of all the stuff that I had submitted or prepared, I think maybe about half was used.
Right.
Wow. And I mean, that means used, like we took that theme and then we did this with it. It doesn't mean necessarily even used as I had originally written it. But something like that, maybe like 50 minutes of music I had written, to submit for the album, and then probably used about 20, 25, I think. And then a lot of stuff just happens in the room too, besides the stuff that you just prepare. Yeah. That's really hard to gauge, because then every you're throwing out maybe a song idea, and then, it gets, maybe that you use the verse that you just sang exactly like that, but then the chorus gets changed by the people in the room, and it's very difficult to gauge all that kind of stuff. You just hope that it all comes out to be a blessing in the end.
I think that's something that not many people realize, how much of the stuff just does not make the cut. I listen back to those early albums, particularly ELP albums, and I kind of think that just basically everything they did in the studio made it onto the record. I don't think it's like that anymore.
Right. Yeah. It maybe it was. I don't know. Ask Carl.
Yeah, right. Well, I mean, Are You Ready, Eddie, or Benny the Bouncer?
Right.
How did that make it on? but I'm glad it did.
But I think, some of that stuff might be like, hey, man, you guys, we have half a day left, and we could really use one more track. Well, what do you guys want to do? I don't know. How about this?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, some of the best things that some of those guys did, I mean, when you find out about the making of those records, A Twist and Shout by the Beatles was only because they hadn't used up all their studio time. John's voice was
right.
Yeah. And John's voice was completely shot. That's why, that's kind of what gives it its whole crazy vibe, is how shot his voice is.
Right.
And you can hear by the end of the song, he can barely sing, Maybe not. He's like really flat. And
yeah,
there's something about the whole thing that just has this energy to it.
Yeah, for sure.
That was just a song that they played in the clubs. And then, so you never know. Sometimes the thing that you do at the last minute that's really that, you just kind of do it really quickly, that can be a really great thing. On this last Transatlantic album, I just had this kind of crazy inspiration to try putting this other song, taking out a section and putting in this other song at the end. And it was called Can You Feel It? And I think I wrote it and did all the demo of it really quickly. I don't know. The whole thing, writing it and doing the demo of it to send to the guys, was about 4 hours total. And because I was getting ready to leave on that RV trip. That's right. Now I remember.
Right.
And so I didn't have much time, and I wasn't sure if it was going to be good. Do you find that sometimes in your writing, you'll do something really quickly sometimes, just throwing it out there, and you don't even know if it's going to work.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I think that used to be a big roadblock for me, because, I wanted everything to be great. But now I've stopped caring about things being great, because I know if this one isn't, then the next one might be.
Yeah.
I'm never sure how it's going to come out, I don't think. I feel silly saying this to my favorite songwriter in the whole world, but I find the fact that you're so prolific very inspiring. Just because I strive to be prolific, but I feel like I have to give myself a reason to be. I find one thing that I really learnt about myself is, you know, doing tours with you, doing tours with Carl, doing Morsefest or whatever it was. I work really hard when I have to, but I'm not the kind of person who I don't have this built-in angst inside me or whatever to get out the outpourings of my heart into a song. So I need to give myself a reason to do that. But do you find the same thing? I mean, I feel like you've just always been prolific and always been creative and just music seems to flow out of you.
Well, sometimes I do hear a lot of music, you know, sometimes it's, you know, I don't necessarily even want it.
Yeah.
Like I'm just like this morning lying in bed and I'm kind of hearing these themes, and sometimes it's not really anything I can use. You know, I'm listening for what I think I can use. Because yeah. some of the ideas that occur to me are just so strange sometimes. My grandson, I have a grandson named Maddox, and he loves this Christmas song that I wrote called Worldwide Sleigh Ride. Santa take me on a worldwide sleigh ride, Santa take me on your sleigh, come on Santa. I mean, it's a funny song, and but kids just love it, you know. And he asked me, how'd you think of that? And I'm like, well, I remember I was on a ski lift in Colorado, and it just played in my mind. I don't know. And so I got off the ski lift and I sang it in my phone, but I didn't actually even write the song for like a year and a half after that. It just sat in my phone, and I kind of remembered I had this silly idea, you know. So I don't know. Sometimes I feel called. Sometimes I feel like God's working on me. I'll want to do something else. I might want to go work out. I might want to go to the pool or something. Yeah. And sometimes I feel like the Lord will be like, no, write it. I never know what it is. It's funny, because then I'll just sort of, like right now I'm writing some songs based on this book that I'm reading. And, you know, so I just kind of, what would it be like? It's like you just kind of create the environment in which the creativity can happen. Right. So I get a little keyboard. I go out on the porch. It's a nice morning. And I get my phone to record any ideas I might have. And I get the book and my tablet of stuff and a cup of coffee. And I sit out there and just kind of go, well, it's almost like if I was going to write something, what would it be?
Right. Right.
And it's an amazing thing. So, I'll just start playing something on the, oh, that's kind of nice. And then, you know, I'll open the book and go, you know, I look for stuff that's going to touch my heart. Like what's touching me? What am I touched about? Cause I feel like music should be, it's the language of emotion. So.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. Yeah.
Whatever that emotion is, you know, whether if it's touching or if it's something with angst in it, as you mentioned, or joy, you know, whatever it is that you're feeling that way, but it's very inexact and very instinctive, as you know.
Yeah, I completely agree about the emotion. It's that's why Twist and Shout was the hit, because because John Lennon is really struggling to play it. It's not a hit because it's a technically perfect performance, is it?
No, it's the feeling of it. Yeah, so if you're trying to write, you know, sometimes, have you ever tried to write a feel-good song?
Yeah, I think so, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like you'll just sit down on the beach and go like, man, this feels so good, the air, just the whole thing, sure. You know.
Yeah.
So you try to capture how you're feeling a lot of the time.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Sometimes people will do like whole divorce albums. Like the whole. That's true. I think Ty Tabor from King's X has a whole, this wonderful album that's all like, yeah, I think Adele, right? Adele's big record.
She's right, like, that's true.
I was going through this breakup of this really bad relationship, and that's me pouring my heart out, you know? So that can be wonderful too. You know, it's...
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
If people, you feel that feeling, you know, whatever that is.
Yeah. Yeah, the first song I ever wrote was about my first breakup. That was my journey into songwriting.
Yeah, well, it's wonderful outlet. You know, I remember when I was, I played in clubs doing covers in LA, wow, for a long time. I mean, it was really... It got very depressing towards the end. From 1984 to, I quit the band, I think in 90, but then I came back and I was like, then I joined a different band and I was subbing and it was even worse, like between like 92 and 93. But I remember being filled with angst sometimes. I was just really angry in those days about a lot of different things. Mm-hmm. You know, traffic lights. You know,
still am. So what band was that? That was like a cover band.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a cover band called Burlesque, but I remember sometimes I'd go in there really sad or really angry or something. And as we would play, I would realize, man, this is great. You know, I could put my anger into the music. You know, or I could put my sadness. Yeah. As we would just be playing these songs, by the third set, a lot of times I was feeling better.
I feel like that, you know, that first Spock's Beard album with The Water. I mean, that's a really angry song, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's almost like you can, I don't know exactly what your journey was, but it's almost like you can see your journey emotionally through the Spock's Beard albums right to the end to Snow. Where it's, you know, it's the brightest and most uplifting of all of the albums.
Yeah, and I didn't know that was happening. I was just writing about some of it I thought was gibberish that now makes a lot of sense to me.
Right. Yeah, sure.
But yeah, The Water, I mean, I lived there. I lived in that place of feeling like, you know, life was kind of when it all goes to hell. You know, being really angry with God, you know, you gave me, I felt a lot in those days, like the Salieri character in the Amadeus movie. I don't know if you've ever seen that, but it's really, I haven't seen it in years, but I remember thinking it was really, really a brilliant movie. I just remember that Salieri is the, one of the composers, and he knows he's just second rate to Mozart. He knows it. And it's like, God, why did you give me this desire?
Yeah.
This burning desire and not give me the wherewithal to see it to fruition. What a cruel thing to do. And so that I felt that way about God for many years.
Right. You know, in relation to who? Who were you looking at thinking they've got the gift or they've got the break or whatever?
Oh, well, you know. It's funny. I was just talking in church this last Sunday about the suffering that comes from comparing.
Right. Yeah.
And the scripture says, you know, you're unwise to compare yourselves with yourselves. And who I compared myself to, and I was never measuring up, mainly was Peter Gabriel.
Okay. Right.
I remember saying, well, you know, because I would throw parties sometimes in LA, and you know, hardly anybody would show up, and If I was Peter Gabriel, they would have showed up. I remember saying it. Because I would be lamenting, and people would always try to cheer me up. And they would say, well, you know, it's just that people are busy and your friends are mostly musicians and some of them have gigs and then you don't want to drive. You know, they have all these things. And I'd just say, well, if Peter Gabriel was throwing a party, they'd figure out a way to get there. Yeah, you know, and so for me, it just wasn't, it wasn't working out, and I knew I had something, and I knew, and I couldn't, I came to a point in the 90s, because most of the time, every time I got rejected by a label, I would just go like, ah, well, they're, what a bunch of idiots, listen to all this junk on the radio. Like, so they signed this guy, but they won't sign me. What a bunch of morons.
Yeah.
So basically, what a horrible way to be walking around in the world.
Yeah.
Just thinking, what a bunch of morons, kind of about everybody.
Yeah, sure. Sure. Oh, I've definitely been there. Yeah.
And imagine I'm playing cover gigs, right? So we got to play the popular songs of the day. Yeah. Right? So we start, ding, 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 ding. Dan, dan, right, in excess, right? And everybody's like, woo! Yeah. They all come out on the dance floor. I'm like, you morons.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Well, and then I had actually befriended quite a few label guys. I was, you know, I was being shopped and showcasing my songs and, you know, for a long time. And, you know, so I showcased for different guys, and they would actually take my calls, some of them, and A&R guys and whatnot.
Yeah.
I got to this point where I couldn't really say that the record company guys were, you know, wrong or dumb or whatever they were. And I couldn't really say that I didn't think that I had any kind of a, you know, gift that was worth exploring. So the only thing that made any sense to me was that God was torturing me. And it was quite a revelation when I came to that revelation. You know, of course it was funny.
Yeah.
You know, it was funny, but it was also the only thing that I could come up with that made any sense. And, but it did give me some freedom, and I did start writing different music. That was right around the same time that I started writing the Spock Spirit stuff. And I started expressing in that way.
Yeah.
And so it was kind of funny. That was all part of the whole birth of Spock's beard, really, was this kind of giving up.
Yeah. Yeah, that's... I've heard that about a lot of people, you know. I've heard that about... Steve Vai was saying that about, you know, his massive album, Passion and Warfare. He said he wasn't really interested in it being commercial. He just went into the studio with one intern engineer and just thought, you know, I don't really want this to be successful. I just want to do this for me. And all of a sudden it was the biggest guitar instrumental album ever made.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think that's a common thing. And I think it probably comes down to, right, to honesty and you know, honesty in music and writing music for yourself rather than what you think people want to hear, right?
Right. Yeah. You'd think we would all know that.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
I know. Yeah.
We still have to learn it sometimes because my brother and I were trying to have success in the music business for so many years. You know, really depressed. I was.
Right.
He had left music and gone into the business world for a while. It was when we really, you know, gave up and just did this crazy stuff that just really just for, like you said, just for ourselves.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then it really caught on quite well. Even the first record, we didn't even know there was a prog world, really. It was because there was no internet. It was all really underground.
Yeah.
Then, you know, they're somehow mail order or something. They sold like 8,000 CDs. That was pretty amazing with no promotion or anything. Well, of course it bloomed from there. And so where and when did we meet, Paul? I couldn't remember.
Well, I first, when I did my first US tour, I was very excited to be coming over to the US. And that was 2006. So I sent, I aimed to send a load of people, like a load of, you know, my heroes, an email and invite them to our gig. And you were one of them. And actually, I didn't end up sending any more emails after I sent yours out. I kind of went behind the along the wayside. But I sent you an email saying, we're playing in America. Would you like to come to a gig? And not knowing America very well, you said, that would be great, but you're not, I've just checked your dates and you're not playing within 1,000 miles of me. but anyway, we stayed in touch, and then I think we met at some of your gigs with Colin. And then the next year I got an email from you saying, do you want to do a tour?
Well, the first time I recall hearing about you, I was in Barcelona. Do you remember this story?
Yeah, I remember you saying, yeah.
Yeah, I got into the car with a friend of mine there, and I think you and Carl had just played, maybe you'd played in Barcelona recently. And anyway,
so.
Yeah, he was playing me and telling me all about you. He was playing stuff and he was right. So excited. He's a very excitable guy, this friend of mine there, and he was very excited about you. And I think maybe he met you and talked with you or something. So he was encouraging me to work with you.
And right. Then, wow.
And then a couple of years later, I guess it would have been when we were talking about guitar players or something. Or did you meet?
Yeah.
Did you meet with Colin? Was that how it happened? Or
no, it came for you. I didn't know. I didn't know the. I'd had the introduction. You know, I'd sent the email, and we'd had a few email back and forth. But I didn't know Colin at all.
Yeah, I just, I asked if you could sing and you said, sure.
Yeah. There you go. And then Googled singing teachers. Yeah.
That's funny. Yeah. Well, you did great.
It was only a half lie because I sang in choirs and did that sort of thing. But just never. Well, I play with Carl, you know, there's no microphone except for with Carl. But you know that I'm singing. Did I tell you that I'm singing with Carl now?
No.
Yes, I am now the lead vocalist for Carl Palmer's band.
Wow.
So I'm singing all of the, yeah, yeah, yeah.
You're
good thing
all
I.
All the Greg Lake bits and stuff?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, yeah, we're doing Tarkus and Lucky Man and Knife Edge and. Yeah, loads of stuff. Yeah, so I'm now the lead vocalist, yeah.
Wow.
Which I, you know, it all came from me telling you a half-truth about being able to sing.
I'm thinking about singing Tarkus. How much fun would that be? Clear the battlefield and let me see.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you do a much better job than me. Well, as you know, we did that show at the Grand Ole Opry and on that tour with Arthur Brown.
Yes.
Singing. And I just was thinking, going back to just instrumental versions of it all, it feels like a step down rather than a step up. So I, a little before that, I'd experimented with using a vocoder. So whenever, you know, the guitar was playing the melody lines to some of these songs, at least we could have some kind of hint of the lyrics, even though it is a strictly... instrumental band, but it was my understanding that Carl always wanted it to be an instrumental band, so the subject of vocals never came up. But then we got a few guest vocalists with us, and then I thought, well, why not? I'll see if I can go to some singing lessons and see if I can do this. And sure enough, we turned up at a rehearsal. Very rarely have rehearsals with Carl. It's usually just all worked out in sound checks. But I guess letting me near a microphone required a rehearsal to see if it was going to be horrendous or not.
Right.
So we had a rehearsal, and I expected Carl to say, oh, yeah, do this song, but not this, this, and this. And by the end of the rehearsal, it was like, yeah, sure, let's do it. So... I'd say half the songs that we're doing now have got vocals. So it's completely different band from when you saw us last.
Oh, wow. Still three-piece.
Still three-piece, still the same lineup. And I'm using a lot of MIDI sounds now. I don't know if... Oh, you will have seen that on the Royal Affair Tour, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so yeah. That Royal Affair Tour was the first time I was using all of the MIDI sounds. I got with an amazing company called Jam Origin, and they do this software called MIDI Guitar 2. And basically, you just plug your guitar into a regular interface, and it converts everything with hardly any latency at all to MIDI data you can send to a VST or whatever, and it's polyphonic, and it's just incredible.
Wow.
So everything I play has got like a Hammond behind it or a Moog sound behind it. So yeah, I feel like the band has really, really changed over the last, well, I would say year, but obviously it's done nothing over the last year, but
right.
Yeah, the last year of it playing, yeah, completely different.
Oh man, I love that gig so much that you guys did. That was really a special set you guys did. I thought Carl's drum solo at the end was fabulous, and yeah, very, very impressive. I enjoyed that.
You mean the one the one at the Grand Ole Opry?
Yeah, I love it, man.
It really was.
Don't you love those gigs where you get to like travel all over and you're only playing for like a half an hour? Right?
No, less, because I think, you know, 7 or 8 minutes of that half hour slot was Carl's drum solo.
Right. Yeah, I remember when Stox was opening for Dream Theater. I mean, it was so much fun for me. I mean, because I'm a bit of a travel adventurous, you know, adventurer, you know, enthusiast. And it was amazing. So, you know, we'd be in like Helsinki. We were done well before the sun went down, you know.
Right.
We played from like 7:15 to 7:45, and then we're done. Yeah. It was so easy. What an easy gig.
Yeah.
Of course, we were losing money hand over fist, but it didn't matter.
Oh, is that right?
Oh, yeah.
But I tell you what, you were gaining fans though, because I feel like that was a big introduction for me to Spoxbeard. I was aware of the band, but seeing you guys, particularly alongside Dream Theater, because I feel like it was the polar opposite of Dream Theater. I think you gained a lot of fans on that tour. Yeah, it was.
Yeah, I know that we did. I know that we did. It wound up being a really, really, really good thing for the band.
Yeah.
But yeah, we, of course, you know, we were going into debt, but we didn't care because, you know, it was, we were in a moment, an upward momentum, and that's what you do. I mean, it was a really good thing.
Yeah.
For us. So we're very grateful.
Yeah.
Dream Theater for letting us be a part.
I think I saw you on every UK date of that Dream Theater Spoxbeard tour.
Oh, did you really? Yeah. So I wanted to ask you about how you got the gig with Carl.
So the gig with Carl, so that came out of, I was teaching at a college in England, down in Brighton, and another teacher there was a guy who's absolutely blown up now on the internet, and well, I think YouTube had a lot to do with him getting famous, but a guy called Guthrie Govan, do you know him?
Yeah, I've heard of him. Yeah, sure, yeah.
He was teaching there, yeah. Yeah, so he was like the guitar player everyone was talking about in the UK. So Carl did have a version of the band before I joined, but it was kind of like I wouldn't say a jazz trio, but it was the same sort of basis, but just you know, very, very raw, no effects on any of the guitars or anything like that, and just kind of, yeah, imagine jazz played through a Marshall stack. It was that sort of thing, but with a great, great guitar player called Sean Baxter. And Sean left the band. He had to leave the band for, I think it was health issues, but he left the band. So Carl was looking around for another guitar player, and Guthrie was recommended. Guthrie couldn't do it because he was then playing in the version of Asia with John Payne, so he recommended me. So I contacted Carl, said that, you know, I've been recommended to him, and you know, I'm interested in joining the band. And Carl said, oh, I'm really sorry, we've already found a guitar player. But if you want to send me a CD, then it's not going to harm. So I didn't, you know, it was back in the days before I had a recording setup. So this would have been 2003. So I went round to my friend's house, scrambled together a CD, sent it up to him, and put it together in a day, sent it up to him. And I got a phone call when the mail arrived, because we didn't email things, when the mail arrived, saying, I love your CD, listen to it, I'd like to offer you the post for as guitarist. I was like, well, what about the other guy? Oh, well, you know, it's not going to happen anymore. So so that was that. And then no rehearsal. No audition, just a couple of days rehearsals, and then I was on my first tour with him. So that was probably the most intense period of learning music that I've ever had. Particularly at the time, because I was teaching at college, but I was also just out of college. So I kept saying every single tune I was learning was the most difficult thing I'd ever learned. And we were doing like a, you know, an hour and 45 minutes of every single tune was the most difficult thing I'd ever, ever played. So that was that. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. That's amazing. What was on the CD?
What was on my CD that I sent him? I think the reason why it kind of pricked up his ears was there was a lot of classical inspired things on there. So I did a version